Welcome back to our laboratory of the endless exploration of Chernobyl technologies. Just look what I got. So this thing is some sort of a control panel from the large Soviet mainframe computer. And today we're gonna restore it and also talk about how this thing was supposed to work. Well, I have to say that this kind of panels, they became quite rare now because after those computers were mostly scrapped, this became highly collectible item because they're visually very beautiful. So here we have almost 300 such light indicators and more than 100 switches. Some of those are broken and there's a big work ahead, but I guess that when we'll finish that, that will look really gorgeous and will find its place in a computer museum. So let's do it. So what this panel is? Well, at first glance it gave me a strong vibe that it came from something from the 50s. But then when I checked dates on components as well as inscriptions, I realized that this device was made actually in 1980. It was a part of the interface channel multiplexer for ES-1050, one of the Soviet IBM 360 clones. So inside this rack there were a few such frames with mounted crates with circuit boards, and here you can also see our panel. So it allowed to connect various peripherals such as tape roll drives, hard disks, punch tape readers, tape machines and much more. And this panel allowed to make a low-level diagnostics of connections and make necessary tests, so during operation it was blinking like a Christmas tree. Well, given that we are mostly focused on Chernobyl-related hardware, of course I've checked specialized literature, and it appeared that ES-1050 mainframes were never used in the Chernobyl zone as there were installed different models. But I found that one of those was installed at Kursk nuclear power plant, which is very similar in many aspects to its Chernobyl counterpart. So before all, I went for some shopping for old electronic components, so I got a few hundred of indicators with matching lens, as well as some replacement switches. Those used in our panel are the type MFS1, and they have to be secured with two tiny screws. Another type is MFS2, which you mount inside a round opening. All those were designed in the 60s, so they are based on a very tiny bayonet light bulbs. Inside is a spring, so the only way to install or remove them is to use a little piece of rubber tube. If a light bulb is broken, like in our case, it's really hard to remove its parts. Atop the light bulb, a cover glass lens is placed, and there were a few colors available. The most common was white, which made a yellow light. Then there were red and green. Less common were orange, and I heard there existed also blue. But honestly, I never saw any of those. Well, technically we need just lens, and they unfortunately not sold separately, so I needed to remove all and sort them by color. Well, it took some time, as many were firmly stuck inside. So this is what we got, and good news is that we have a lot of those beautiful orange colored. Okay, for now we put all that aside, because first we need to disassemble everything. The indicators are grouped on small socket boards, which are interconnected with wire mesh. Well, unfortunately it was cut away, so later we also need to repair it. Apart from that, everything looks generally intact, but there are a lot of scratches, some rust and damage which we will need to repaint, so I guess I will use the light gray Tamiya model paint for this. So first we remove those little panels with inscriptions, and each of them is secured with four tiny screws. Well, to my surprise, the color under them was slightly different, so I guess the paint burned on the sun over the years. And there is a lot of dirt under. Okay, next we need to remove the broken white bulbs and carefully take out intact ones to be used later, because honestly I don't have enough replacements. In many cases it required using various tools to remove the small broken fragments, and often due to oxidization a light bulb would stuck firmly in its place. Okay, it took me a couple of hours, but I could scavenge from here this much light bulbs. There are approximately 200 of them and they were functional. However, there is a little problem because in some places lamps were completely broken and there is no physical possibility to take them out. So I guess I will just change those indicators completely. For this, we need to disassemble this part. So that's what we are going to do now. To remove those indicator modules, first we need to release the wire mesh, which is secured with a few dozens of small screws. And next we remove 132 small screws that hold them into place. Well, explaining my reaction, it appeared that metal they were made of was really weak. So many screws just broke into the half, while others were really hard to turn. Nevertheless, with certain effort, I successfully removed the indicator modules. And here we ran into a little problem, because those switches, they are secured in their places not only with those tiny screws, but also with nuts, with applied smear of paint. And the problem that those nuts are not hexagonal in shape, they are round. And together with oxidization, that's absolutely not possible to disassemble, no matter how much I tried. So I guess I could drill them out, but given that there is already quite extensive wiring, that would be a real complication to assemble that all back. So I think I'll try to fix as much as possible this as is. Maybe we'll have, you know, a couple of switches non-functional, but that's, I guess, a pretty minor problem. So let's try to continue. Next, after good cleaning of the surface, I started to apply base paint. I also mixed it with another color to make it a bit brighter. And this is what we got. The reason why I didn't use a glossy paint are those panels with inscriptions. As you can see, the text is embossed into the metal, so the way to paint them is to apply the base paint and let them dry. And then we add a thin layer of white paint over. While the white paint is wet, it's possible to swipe most of it away, making inscriptions white on a new background. The result probably is not as good as it would be made in industrial way, but honestly, I do not aim for ideal quality. The white paint applied in this way makes the surface semi-glossy and it also adds some texture, so in the same way we'll apply it to the main panel and spread it with dry paper and let it dry. So this is what we got. I also used a bit of brown paint to remove scratches on the switches, given that they are not replaceable. Well, to my mind, looks quite good. And now back to light modules. So there is a lot of compacted dust inside and on them, so I needed to make a multi-step cleaning on each single part. Once all of them were clean, I removed those indicators which had remains of light bulbs I could not pull out, and then placed new on their places. Altogether I changed around 20 of them, which honestly was not as bad as I initially expected. Well, and now remained just a little. All we need to do is to assemble back roughly 1000 parts together. It took approximately 1.5 hours, but after, this is what we got. I also installed panels with inscriptions in their places. Next, we need to install light bulbs, but given that they are old and Soviet, I decided to check each of them using a 3R12 battery. As it appeared, it was quite convenient. Okay, now all 300 light bulbs are in their places, and now it's a time to place those colorful lamps. The color to choose depends on the function. Well, some acronyms I know, and also I found some other in literature, but many are machine-specific, so to be honest, I understand their meaning only approximately. Originally, this panel allowed to work with interfaces and connected devices on a very low level. So, most of left column, bottom row and entire right column are registers of various purpose, address, data and so on. You could choose which will be put on indication by toggling those two switches, and using other switches you could set up specific bytes bit by bit. That said, for every byte of the register we will use white lines for data bits and orange one for a control bit. In left column there are also two rows of flag indicators and a row for malfunction warning signals. Warning indicators will be red and flags will be orange. The central part, based on acronyms used here, gave a status of a chosen channel interface line as well as status of a system bus. It also indicated requests and responses between the channel controller and the device connected, and also it indicated errors in operation. The central part will have different colors, red for warning, green for bus status, orange for what I assume channel status, and the rest I will make white. Well, after all the variations of lens we got give certain limitations. Okay, so the last one. And just look at this. You know, yeah, maybe something is not correctly chosen, but it looks just awesome. Honestly, I cannot wait to see it in action, so now we need to make it alive again, and it is a time for some wiring. So first I fixed broken internal connections, and then I decided to add long ribbon cables to the cut parts. As the panel technically was a small door mounted inside the frame, that would be the optimal solution. Those original wires used here are thin, but they have a very durable and flexible insulation, which was meant to be burned away instead of cutting. Unfortunately, I do not have a special tool for this, so I used a regular candle and then cleaned them with acid. I decided to use original period ribbon cable, which had 32 ways, but I narrowed it to 28. Then I soldered all that together, securing each connection with a shrinkable tube. Well, maybe I better had to make connections more compact by shortening the residuals of those pink wires, but honestly, that would take much longer time to do. Well, after that the energy went down, because now in Ukraine we have very serious problem with the energy supply, so I spent that time cleaning the rest of wires and preparing more ribbons. Well, I have to say, those ribbon cables added really much weight. So, after all 308 connections were done, this is what we got. I plugged the random lines of the ribbon cables into batteries and... wow, that's beautiful. Well, right now I'm using 12-volt source, so it is not that bright as it should be, but unfortunately I don't have a more powerful light at the moment. Anyway, this looks much better than I expected. So, this is it. Well, it took me approximately 10 days to achieve this result, but I have to say I'm pretty much satisfied. Though my original idea was to wire also some of those switches to some indicators to simulate the operation, but now I think we can make something more interesting if we find a way how to integrate this piece of historical hardware into something meaningful, I don't know, say some insane computer case mod or something like that. So if you have any ideas or suggestions, just feel free to share them in the comments and maybe we will do that. And in meantime, don't forget to check our Patreon page, because you'll find there a lot of interesting. And stay tuned for our new videos, and see you next time. I still have some unused red indicators.
Okay, let's try.